order at 6:37. If everyone will join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And so we know we have board members here. We have Megan Conley, active board member, on the phone. We also have Terry O'Shea, who is elected but has not yet been sworn in, who will be on the phone as well. They're on a conference call, but Terry won't be voting, but she's participating. Do we have all the other newly elected folks were sworn in? All the other meaning too?
Yes.
Wonderful. So the first thing I want to do in terms of agenda review, we do have some students here, and Rich Ballard from MVU, who want to talk about the STEM Fair presentation. Rather than doing that after our organization, I would like to have those students go first, and then we'll move forward with nominations for chair and vice chair, etc. Is that agreeable to everybody?
Sure.
Perfect. So please.
So we're going to, I think we'll start with a, I'm Rich Ballard, STEM Fair Director up at MVU, and so what we're going to do is we got a short video from last year. I'll redo a new one, but this has all the way through states and everything, which hasn't happened last year. We did our presentation after state, so I was able to make that video for you guys just to kind of show it. And then we have actually our top middle school student and our top high school student, which both happen to be sisters, but you know, besides the point. And so they're going to just tell you briefly. We'll have them, you know, come up here and talk to you guys briefly about what they did. There's also the posters over there of the second and third place finishers. Unfortunately, or fortunately, these kids that tend to do really well on these are also our most active kids in the community. So, you know, one of them's over at hockey and one of them's down doing the musical. And so trying to get everybody to come was a little bit difficult. But we did get a couple, so it'll give you a chance to see what the kids did. I really am excited how well our kids did this year. We've got about 20 kids going to the State STEM Fair, which is down in Norwich, at Norwich University. That's the end of March, so the end of this month. We are also working on a, where we're going to go to the elementary schools. We're going to come here, we're going to go to Swanton and hopefully up to Franklin, where we're going to actually present to the fifth and sixth graders. And we did this last year, and it was just amazing. The kids had lots of great questions. Our kids got, you know, just kind of set up in a round here. And the fifth and sixth graders came running around and just asked them all kinds of questions. It was great prep for them to get ready for states. So that's going to be happening, I believe, in 2 weeks also. So that's coming right up. So we got a few things that are happening with the STEM Fair. But why don't we go ahead and we can show the short video here. I don't know if it matters if you want to go off, but we could get the sound, so you're just going to have to. There was some music underneath it. Last year here at the elementary school. volunteered to go first, so I will get her up here. Ella took first place, as I said. She's actually taken first place for the last 3 years. So she took first place as a eighth grader for the middle school science fair. She took first place last year as a ninth grader, and she's repeated. So it helps to have your grandfather's. No, it helps to have a great brain.
This year I did my project on the effectiveness of various name brand contact solutions on minimizing bacterial growth on silicone hydrogel contact lenses. So what I was just trying to figure out was really testing the effectiveness of five different commonly used contact solutions. So I did this by, I had 40 individual contacts, and that meant that I had essentially eight different trials of my experiment. Kind of in my poster, I'll just kind of go over it quick. We have the problem statement. So this just kind of explains the importance of the situation. It's important to use effective cleaners when it comes to contact lens wearers because they're at a higher risk for developing bacterial infections of the eye and microbial keratitis. My hypothesis was that the BioTrue solution made by Bosch and Lomb would be the most effective contact solution. It would limit the growth of bacteria on a petri dish. And my main reasoning for this was just because it's what ophthalmologists often recommend people to use. So I kind of did some background research, and my procedure kind of goes more into the nitty-gritty of what I did, but basically what I did was I took a contact, put it on a petri dish, and that contact had been soaked for about 6 to 8 hours in a certain assigned solution, and I had five different solutions, as I mentioned earlier, as well as a saline that acted as a control. So what I ended up finding was that the Walmart solution was actually the most effective. It was the Equate brand. And then the one that I had predicted to be the most effective kind of came in second place. And then, of course, the normal saline was the least effective, which I had predicted because it really has no sanitizing elements. And then I typed up, I made some graphs. I took some photos as well. There was some kind of funky, kind of strange bacteria growth that happened. So I took photos of that. But ultimately I concluded that the Walmart brand was the best.
And how did it compare price-wise?
It was much cheaper than the Boston one, yeah.
What gave you that idea?
I wear contacts, and everybody in my family wears contacts. And the contacts that I tested, they had been previously worn by myself, so I'd wear them for the day, and then I would soak them overnight, because I have daily wear ones. But I just kind of thought it was interesting because it pertains to me. It pertains to a lot of people I know. And it's just important because I don't want a bacterial infection of the eye. So, yeah.
Did your whole family switch to Walmart brand?
Three of us have dailies, so we don't really have to worry about that. But my mom still uses the BioTrue. But she also uses a solution that it's like the fizzy one that I didn't test, because I didn't have enough contacts, but yeah.
Very cool.
Very good.
Yeah.
And our youngster.
This is Amelia. She is a seventh grader. Mrs. Hatton's class, and they work very hard as a class on, we have quite a few kids from your group, didn't we? We had probably five or six groups maybe and students that came out of that class in seventh grade. It's been one of the nice things has been seeing the middle school get more and more involved. I think the first year that you were involved, there was probably only about four or five of you, and this year we had, I think, 15, almost 20 middle school students, so we're seeing a big increase in that, which is really a nice thing to see as we're moving on. So go ahead, Amelia, tell us what you were supposed to say.
So my project was testing the acidity of soil in Swanton, Vermont. I tested about 10 soil samples for nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, and pH. And my hypothesis was that most of the soils would be pretty low, since when there are lower amounts of acidity, this means there are more nutrients in the soil and less acidity causing deficiencies. And since we have a lot of farms and we grow a lot of crops in our soils here in Swanton, Vermont, I kind of made the hypothesis that we would have less acidity. So my results were that supported my hypothesis. They were that many of the acidities were low across all four all four chemicals tested for. Some of the higher places were the McQuam Shore boat launch and a cornfield that floods a lot. A few errors that could have occurred were just making, when I took the samples, maybe I took like a deeper amount of soil, which means that the nutrients in the different levels of soil could have been taken at different amounts. So I did my background research and my process was pretty intricate. I did different tests for each chemical, and they were each like a little different but kind of similar, and I would test the sample color with a chart at the end, and that would kind of tell me about how acidic. Usually the more colorful the colorful samples were more acidic. So basically it resulted that Swanton is a good place to grow crops because of the soil.
Good thing.
Any questions?
I'm just wondering if either of you young women who have shown an interest and aptitude in science through this process, has it made you interested in the sciences for your future?
Yeah, it's definitely kind of helped me be more of aware of like the possibilities that I have in my future. I still don't really know like what exactly I'd want to do, but I think I'd definitely consider something in the science field.
That's good.
And you, the same?
Yeah, same for me. I find it interesting, so yeah.
Good.
That's what we want. So.
Yeah.
Thank you guys so much for allowing us to present and show the kids do some really good work. The third place winner was Emily King over here, and she actually worked with a UVM professor this year, and she was in a summer intern program down at UVM, and if you can understand her poster, you're doing really good. because it is like, I've talked to my biology teacher, and she knew what she was talking about, and that was what's impressive. So, you know, the kids really did some high-level work. You know, you could see what was going on in some of the different projects here, and so I'm really impressed with what these kids can do. I'm excited to how they're going to do at States this year. I think we're going to see some really good results this year at States. So,
thank you very much. With the organization of our meeting after a town meeting, the first piece of business would be to nominate a board chair. Are there any nominations for board chair?
I'll nominate Chris Shepherd.
Chris Shepherd is nominated. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Jen. Are there any other nominations? Other nominations? Nominations being closed. All in favor for Chris Shepherd as board chair, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. So we'll keep right on going down the list. The next nomination I'll look for is a nomination for vice chair.
I nominate Devin Batchelder for
so
vice chair.
I have a first. Don nominated Devin Batchelder for vice chair. Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Peter Magnet second. Any other nominations? Hearing none, all those in favor of nominating Devin Batchelder as our vice chair, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Congratulations. Motion carries 8-0. Next, I'll have a nominate. Can Terry and Megan, can you hear me?
Did we lose it?
We did.
We lose that one.
I think we did. Let me try again. I'll go back here so that we're not interrupting anybody.
All right, so we'll move on to the nomination for clerk.
Well, can we wait till we get them back, being that Megan was the clerk?
You can nominate her.
I'll nominate Megan.
So we have a nomination for Megan Connolly.
She hung up.
Second.
And Devin seconded. For voting, do you want to wait? Lord, want to wait for them to vote, or keep right on
track?
Go get it anyways.
Yeah.
All right. All those in favor of nominating Megan for board clerk, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. And we'll correct the both the chair and vice chair were 7-0 instead of... next one is authorization for board chair to sign teachers' contracts.
I make that motion.
Steve was first. We need a second.
Can we talk about that motion later when we do, and I can't get them, the calls keep failing. Later when we do annual motions, one of the things that we realized we wanted to have was to authorize the board chair and vice chair, if the chair is not available, to sign professional staff contracts and federal grants as needed. I didn't know if you wanted to include that in this motion, even just if you wanted to keep it to teacher contracts now and do grants later, that's fine. But adding the vice chair if the board chair is not available.
Since it's your motion, do you want to amend?
I do.
Okay, so the new motion is to authorize the board chair or vice chair to sign teacher contracts.
Yes.
And we're still looking for a second.
A second.
Jen was second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of authorizing the board chair or vice chair to sign teacher contracts, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Next is to set our date and time for regular board meetings.
So I apologize. I'm not just playing on my phone. I'm letting the board members who were disconnected know that I tried again and failed. I'll do that in another minute.
I'd move that we stay with the Tuesday, first and third Tuesdays.
Yeah, I mean that's I think worked out for the board.
Yep, I agree. I like it.
It seems to interfere with less school activities, too. It
does, actually. Yeah.
And the other thing, when I suggest that last year, I know what it's like. You come in on Monday, you got a board meeting Monday night, and everything falls apart already. So I like Tuesdays.
So, and keep the 6:30 time also?
6:30 is fine.
So we have a motion to...
I'd like to motion that we change it to 6 instead of 6:30.
How's the rest? Well.
Or could we split it into two different votes, doing doing the Tuesdays and then vote on the time?
I think we could lump it together. We can just, are you willing to amend it to 6 instead of 6:30?
You know, it might work fine for me, but there are other people around the table that have different jobs, so I guess I would... Anybody that's going to really make
well,
it binding.
I'm just trying to get the motion in place so we can go to the discussion.
Ah, okay. I'll take him. No, I'm not going to amend it. We're going to do them separately.
All right. So at this time, the motion is to leave the date and time as is. So we're first and third Tuesday and our start time at 6:30. Don is the first. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Devin. Discussion.
I would like to do I have to make a motion or just
no,
a
just
general discussion?
Discussion.
Propose that we change the time until 6 o'clock
so
that we're not running so late at night.
So just by straw poll, how many people does 6 o'clock work for?
Does it work for?
Yep.
If it works for everybody, that's great.
I prefer 6:30, but
I'd
can
also
make
like to
6
add it,
work.
It'll be a little bit easier for the principals and vice principals since they're here all day. And if they have to stay here and they live away, you're welcome. So I'm also taking that into consideration as well.
So I hear what you're saying, Jen. The 6:30 time is kind of nice for some of us who have to, you know, drive up to Franklin and then come back down, because we do have a considerable number of our meetings in Swanton, because the MVU one is every single month. And so I would wonder if the board would be willing to look at where how we handle the rotation of locations, you know, to kind of even that out a little bit. I think that might, that would make the 6 o'clock a little easier for me personally. I don't know the rest of you think, but you know, something like 1 month is in, both meetings are in Swanton, and then the next both are in Highgate. And because I don't know if there's a pressing reason to have the central office one at MVU every time. So,
well, it's not just the central office one, it's also the MVU meeting.
Well, MVU would have the MVU, so we'd have four locations, would be my proposal. But right now, we do the second meeting every month, the central office, and always at MVU. So, what if that one is also just wherever the first one was held? Would kind of even out.
I don't personally have a problem with that. I don't know.
The time doesn't matter to me either way.
So at this point,
so I'm not making a motion on the location. I'm just saying that 6 o'clock is easier if we talk about that next, I guess.
Well, the motion is for 6:30, so at this point we would have to vote that one down and move on, or have a motion to amend the motion.
Devin, are you discussing having different meeting times for different places?
No.
Okay.
No.
Jen, because I remember when we first talked about this, it may have been way back when we have a transition committee, and Chris at that time was a little more dynamic and forceful than he is tonight. He's trying to play the role of the chair, which he's doing very well, but I really appreciate if he's out there on a job somewhere. Would you be willing to look at 6:15 or as a time? I mean, if he's out on a job, every 15 minutes is important to get back and say another. I mean, for me, I can probably come at 5:30, but I just want to make sure we're sensitive to everybody being able to get here and feel they're prepared to get here.
So when I first got on boards, I think our start time was 6. Then we moved it to 6:15 because everybody was late every time. I was one of them, but we were all late. And then somewhere along the way, we're always starting at 6:30 anyway, so we just started with 6:30. But if it's 6, I'll make it work. That's all.
Well, we can make it right until you get here too. Just, you know, whatever the situation.
Yep. So I'm fine with 6. So at this point, we can have a. We just need a.
Would 6:15 work better for you?
Doesn't matter. I mean, really, we're only talking about 15 minutes. I can make it work.
It's no big deal.
It is a big deal. I mean, it's everybody's. You know.
It's not that big of a deal. If it was, I would. I'd say so. Just shorten my lunch.
You're the boss.
Exactly. So, at this point, I guess we need a motion to adjust, unless Don's willing to amend his motion to 6.
Sure, if that's what people want. I just want to make sure everybody had a voice.
And are you willing to amend, second the amendment?
Because
you were the second on the motion, so.
Was I?
Yep.
Sure.
So now our current motion is to keep our the Tuesday, first and third Tuesday, and change our start time to 6 p.m. instead of 6:30. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of adopting first and third Tuesday starting at 6 p.m., signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No
abstentions?
One no.
One no. Actually, it's two no's. Okay. So be 5-2. It passes.
We have two no's for that.
Yep.
I really think we should all be on the same page. If 6 doesn't work for everybody, I don't think we should do 6.
If that's why we're voting against it. I know it passed, and we could do that, but
I would
just like, we're one board. I think we should all, the time we're going to meet, we should agree on.
I guess as one of the no's, I don't think there's a perfect time that's going to fit everybody. I think there's going to be somebody that has to make it work, and we had, to me, 5, you know, we had a majority, so I'm willing to make it work.
I agree. As the other no.
On that discussion, the two no's were the chair and the vice chair.
Yeah.
Just want to point it out. So do we need
so who's chair and when they're not?
Clerk
Megan.
Jen, I think.
I'm just saying.
I mean, if 6:30 was working, I mean, I'm fine either way. I just want to make sure. Personally, I just think it. We want to have is make it available for everybody as much as we can, and not make it so it's hard for some people to be there. That's just my opinion.
Is Megan on the line?
Now, what I just she's texted me a couple questions, and I just reached out to her to see if she wanted Tanya. If maybe you would take my phone and try and call her a few times. It just it keeps failing.
I ask because I think sometimes she struggles to make it here.
I can
because
I think she may be one that struggles too. And I'm thinking the same thing.
Yes, because
yeah,
she's coming from Winnesky now.
Come
yeah.
Even late at 6:30.
Yeah. Or maybe your phone would be better.
What's
meeting?
All right. So what's the board's pleasure?
Can we, like?
Can we come back to that after?
Yeah, after we talk to Megan.
We have 6:30 posted for the rest of this year.
Or keep 6:30 and then revisit it. And we have everybody here and everybody can voice their opinion. It's fair to everybody.
We can do that. So we would have to. See, we've already voted. So that means we have to have another motion to amend our previously voted on a motion.
I'll withdraw my original motion.
I don't think you can because we already voted.
So I'll make a motion to go back to 6:30 until we have a full board and we can reconsider it.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Okay. So the new motion on the floor is to go back to the way it was, basically. First and third Tuesday, 6:30, till we have a full board to discuss this. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions, motion carries 7-0. So we are now back to 6:30 start times.
And it gives everybody some time to think about it too.
Yep. Okay, next we need to fill our three committees. So first up is Finance Committee. I'll take a motion for three members to be on the committee.
Is it you, Megan, and Tuas?
Devin.
Oh. I make a motion for Steve, Megan, and Devin to be on the Finance Committee.
Second.
I'll second that.
Peter was the second. Discussion. Hearing none, all those in favor of having Steve Scott, Devin Batchelder, and Megan Connolly be on the Finance Committee, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Professional negotiations.
So the only thing I want to bring up about that is the fact that changing the third person, I would want the board to consider whether we want to have a third person come in on that negotiations when we're so far in.
I agree. So just to make sure everybody knows, Don and I are currently on professional negotiations. Eric Borgard was on professional, but obviously he's not on board anymore, so... Do we want to fill his spot?
I'm going to agree with Julie that we shouldn't fill the spot so late into the negotiations.
We should not.
Okay.
That was your recommendation?
Oh, I asked you to consider. I didn't recommend one thing or another.
I think it should be. I think it should be the vice chair. That's traditionally been chair and vice chair.
I don't think I'm allowed to do that.
He's
one.
Not.
He can't do that one. He's the one person that can't.
I know that.
Causing so much.
You know,
trouble.
Is there somebody on the board who was not on negotiations that would like to be on negotiations? You won't get a chance to talk because Chris Snowdell is talking, mainly me, but as the chair. But if somebody would like to say, yeah, I'd like to sit in on that and see how
well,
you...
That's what I'm wondering. If, you know, if we nominated Joanne, is it a problem that she sits in on it? I mean...
I don't have a problem with it at all, and it's a great way to learn to be a lot of the behind
future.
The scenes.
Because who knows, when we negotiate in 2 or 3 years, you might be the chair.
You better make all the meetings.
No, I like that idea. I like the idea of giving her the option if she feels comfortable joining us.
I'm comfortable observing, learning.
You do learn a lot, I can tell you that.
Yeah,
and that's why I'm here.
That's it's definitely an expedited way to learn a lot. So at this point, I would entertain a motion to have Don, myself, and Joanne be on professional negotiations.
So moved.
Second.
Peter first, Devin second. Any discussion? Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0.
Congratulations.
You'll love it.
So in the spirit of keeping things the same as we've done, I guess I'd entertain a motion to have Jen, Peter, and
Terry
be on support staff negotiations.
So moved.
I got Devin first. Here a second. Need a second.
Oh, I'll second that.
Oh, you're tall.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Any discussion? Steve's volunteered.
Devin
made the motion.
I thought I heard you say Peter seconded it. That's why.
I thought he did too.
You did? Maybe you did.
I didn't, no.
No.
But you're having so much fun.
I was sure he did.
So, any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of nominating Terry, Jen, and Peter for support staff and negotiations, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. And designation of newspaper?
Yeah. When we were researching the annual motions that we need to make, and it's interesting, some school districts do things annually just because they like to, and then there's some things that you're supposed to do. So that was part of our figuring out what we wanted to do. One of the things we came across we're supposed to do is designate a newspaper that where we post things and that becomes the newspaper of information. And we have always used the St. Albans Messenger, but we didn't designate it formally in a board meeting. So since we came across that, we thought that we should make a motion that the Missisquoi Valley School District designates the St. Albans Messenger to be the official newspaper. Ads notices will also be posted on the Missisquoi Valley School District site. And.
Okay, so I'll entertain a motion to designate the St. Albans Messenger as the MVSD's official newspaper.
I'll make a motion.
Devin was the first.
Need a second.
Second.
Jen was the second. Any discussion?
Yes. I just kind of want to throw it out there. I've been disappointed in St. Albans Messenger in the last year and a half. I actually dropped my own subscription to it. Used to read it faithfully daily. Am I not the only one that's kind of dropped away from St. Albans Messenger? And is there another avenue that we should be taking? The paper's gotten very skinny.
You're not alone.
Okay.
It's the only daily newspaper we have in our area that we really can designate. but you're not, that's why I think it's important for us, in addition to having a newspaper where we place ads and notices, that we use other forms such as our websites and Facebook and other opportunities as well. But
another question to that, to kind of what he said a little bit, just because we designate the Messenger, does that mean that's the only paper we can?
No.
So
no.
We could put stuff in the Courier or the Free
Absolutely.
Press if we so choose.
Did we designate the Courier?
It's not a daily newspaper, so it's a challenge with, if that's our only place, then we're not able to get notices out in a timely manner. That's a challenge. But we use them.
Yeah, I'm just thinking if we, and maybe Jay has a good point, if we could nominate both, because then people know to look there. You know, if they to look at, they could look at both. But I just think that, and I understand what you're saying, that timeliness, you know, they come out on Wednesday or whatever, and if you miss that, you're not going to get another chance till the following week to get
right.
it in there.
It would not be helpful in terms of board warnings and
yeah.
things like that.
Coverage.
So in terms
yeah.
of the official. Do we use it for advertisements and such? Absolutely we do.
I would encourage the board to stay with the Messenger and encourage administration whenever possible if we can use the Courier. But I think we've already heard you say you would. But I would encourage you to stay with that. Ran up against that at a previous job, and it can get a little tricky having more than one newspaper. If one prints it and the other one doesn't for whatever reason. So. I would stay officially with the one Messenger, even though I don't get excited about it either.
Any other discussion? So we're ready to vote. All those in favor of designating the St. Albans Messenger as our official newspaper, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0.
Chris, before we move on to number 5 with the correspondence, visitors, and public comments, can we revisit back to the Finance Committee? As Megan said, that it's getting very difficult for her to be on the Finance Committee due to her new job.
Oh, did she text that?
She texted
did.
It to me. She said she wants to avoid finance because the move is making it very difficult. She said if it's between that and negotiations, she would stick with finance, but it's difficult.
Did
so
she say she wanted to be on negotiations?
No, she said if it was between the two, she would stick with finance.
Oh,
she
I
wants to.
Oh,
that's
about
what it is. Just to let you know.
I'll have an out.
Can we...
Do you want to revisit that at another board meeting?
That full
There's
board.
No reason why we can't.
Yeah, I was going to say.
We
like,
redo
okay.
it.
We have two already.
We so. Can just readdress it at the next meeting. At that point, we'll put her on for now, and then we'll readdress it at the next meeting. Yeah, you need me to do these too, right? This is our annual.
That one we can do later under annual motions if you want, or you can do it now, whichever.
Okay, I got
you.
You
sort of divided
yep.
them up.
Nope, that's fine. So now we're on to. Correspondence, visitors, and public comments. We don't have any public, and I have no correspondence, so we're going to move on from that.
Chris, I would like to amend the agenda. If we're not too late tonight, I'd like to do kind of a debriefing from our budget meetings and our budget. I think we gained some really good suggestions
mm-hmm.
in a couple of places, and I'd like to put them forth and let other people share. So we can get it in minutes, and then I'll suggest that we schedule it like for September or October, because I think we have some really good suggestions about budget, but more about communications.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure Julie, Laura won't lose them, but I want the whole board to make sure they're on the same page.
Yeah. And this is a nice place in the agenda to thank the community
yes.
as well.
So we'll put that, Don, under new business.
That's
under
fine.
D.
And we don't have to do any action, but I just I just think it should be in the minutes. People took their time to share with us ways to improve our reporting, and I think we should acknowledge it. And then if it's written, we'll probably follow up on it.
Okay. Also under, Julie made a great suggestion under public comments. This is a great time to thank our voters for passing our budget and voting on all of our school issues and positions that we needed. Thank you very much. We appreciate the support.
Do we usually put something in the newspaper like the Courier and Messenger from the board chair or the superintendent or someone?
We can do that. You did Facebook, but we can do something. That's the role of the board.
Okay, so on to approval of minutes from February 18th. I'll entertain a motion to approve those.
I'll make that motion.
Steve was the first. Second?
Second.
Devin was second. Discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of approving February 18th minutes? Anybody saying aye?
Aye.
Opposed?
And Chris, I wasn't here, but I'm not abstaining because I believe legally I can vote yes or no.
Yep. Where was I? I got my eyes. Noes, abstentions, motion carries 7-0. Okay. Presentations. Well, first up is the MVU admin.
Was with us in earlier in February. She worked with our high school teachers for 2 days. The visit always begins with classroom visits and observations, and we were very encouraged by the implementation of the practices that we have been supporting teachers to try. We saw those in action in classrooms with students, including increased talk about mathematics, increase in rigor, and improved questioning from our teachers. We were very encouraged by the progress we saw in the classrooms during that last visit. On February 12th and 13th, Paul Gorski from the Equity Literacy Institute was with our Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee, along with teachers and administration from Sheldon and Swanton schools, to provide training on equity literacy for that group to provide training for faculty and staff in the future. That work was made possible through a competitive grant that we received last year. And actually yesterday we participated in a conference call with the Agency of Education and the other schools across the state that received that grant, so we could hear about the projects that were happening around the state in regard to equity diversity and make some connections with other school districts. So that was a very good opportunity for us. On February 20th, we held our annual history night for 8th grade. So many students, all 8th grade students, work on a multi-week research project in history, and then they present it in the evening and throughout the day. And it's a, you know, one of those traditions that is unique to MVU and a wonderful thing that students remember for a very long time. It's a great opportunity for the community to come in and hear from our students about their learning. I included the state assessment calendar for MVU. We were getting into the time of year where we are administering a variety of state assessments, including 2 weeks from, just a little less than 2 weeks, we are administering the pilot field test for the PISA, which is the Program for International Student Assessment. It's the test that ranks nations. So we're field testing that with 60 students. We were selected by the AOE to do that. So we have a variety of things. Our testing includes science testing, that's the BTSA, PE testing, that's the BTPEA, and then the SBAC in literacy and mathematics. The SBAC happens in grades 7, 8, and 9. The PE test is in 7 and 9. The science test is in 8 and 11. So if you're in grade 10 or 12, you don't have testing, but everybody else is quite busy. Soon we have our 6th grade transition night, which is an important night for our families. To come and learn about the opportunities at MVU as they come to the big round happy house. So that's an important night in our calendar. It's always such great questions, and we love welcoming families into our building for that transition. And we included some events coming up in the next couple of weeks, including high school sports awards, the transition night, which I just mentioned. If you have an opportunity on March 11th, we have our 2nd annual cabaret for high school. This is a new event at MVU where students are selecting their own music to perform in small groups rather than a traditional concert. So this is one of our ways of personalizing the learning in our music department, so students have control over the selections that they make, who they perform with. It's a wonderful event. It was really well received last year. So if you have an opportunity, and then Mr. Thunderbird is coming up as well. And parent-teacher conferences on March 22nd. That's what we have going on. Are there any questions?
Are the spring parent conferences both middle school and high school?
They are.
Very good. Thank you much. Any further questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to the Highgate admin report.
Jenna, is your computer the one that's projecting, I assume?
It is.
So I'm going to share the two documents with you. So I'll go here. Mind just opening the two documents I just sent to your email?
Yep.
Thank you.
Which one would you like up first?
You just open up both of them and I'll toggle when I need to. Thanks.
You're welcome.
We appreciate it. I'm gonna try to just do a quick review of some of the progress we've made with student behavior at Highgate. I feel really good about the progress we've made, and I thought it would be a good time, given that it's about 2.5 years, an appreciable sample size, that would be a good thing to share. So I'm gonna try to do that quickly and painlessly, and hopefully show off some of the progress we've made. So, I think one of the best things that we do is we have a lot of different sources of data, and I tried to cull a few of them. The first thing that I think is maybe most important is how much time kids are spending out of class, because if they're out of class, they're not learning anything. And so we've had a pretty dramatic decline in office discipline referrals over the last 3 years. Progress really started at the end of last year, so even though these 2 years seem pretty similar, it kind of fell pretty dramatically in the second half of last year, too. So we're seeing about a full school year trend at this point of way lower discipline referrals, which means way less kids out of class. That was the thing that shocked me most when I got here, is how much time kids spent out of class. Not that a lot of it wasn't warranted. I mean, sometimes it just is. But it was kind of Pat, when he interviewed me, it was one of the things that so this is going to be part of your mission, is to help us get to a point where kids aren't just revolving door out of the classroom. So that's pretty awesome.
What's causing the improvement?
That's what I'm going to get to when I show that slide. So I'll go through that. One of the other things that's been interesting is not only are the raw number of referrals down, but the percentage of the student body that's responsible for those referrals is also decreasing, which says that there are less kids spending time in contact with administration or behavior support. And we know that when kids do have to have frequent contacts with behavior support personnel, administration, as much as we try our very best to have a good relationship with them, it diminishes their feelings about school. They don't like coming as much. And so decreasing just the number of kids who have to deal with behavior support is another way. What we haven't seen, what I'd like to improve, is a decrease in the number of suspensions. And these, when you think of a suspension, it doesn't mean, most of these are in school at any time. I think part of the reason why suspensions have not fallen, and this is a prorated total, so everything that I've done, I've just kind of prorated throughout 2019, 2020 to make it look, to make it representative. I think part of the reason why we haven't seen suspensions fall is we're doing a better job tracking any kid who is in the planning room for an amount of time that should constitute an in-school suspension. So that might be a kind of a statistical artifact. Kids are definitely spending less time in the planning room for long periods of time. I think we're just tracking better this year. That being said, I still think there's some progress to be made in terms of not excluding kids from the classroom for long amounts of time. One of the things I think I'm most proud of, and this really goes to some of the hiring decisions that Pat has made, as well as a lot of effort from our partnerships with NCSS, a lot of the folks that I'm going to go through in a minute, is the you're not going to be able to see that, I'm going to summarize it, the perceptions of student behavior and our mindset. I think a lot of the reason why is because of the way we think about behavior has shifted dramatically since I've been here. It's been really a pleasant surprise. So, because you can't really read it, I'm just going to show you can see the colors, which is all you kind of need. This is asking not how are students behaving, but how do you think students are behaving? One color is getting better, one is staying the same, one is getting worse. When I first arrived in 2017, 2018, we were in a pretty hard place, and Pat can speak because he has 2 years even prior to that. Was 2017, 2018 kind of fairly representative of the year prior and the year prior to that? Okay, so we had some pretty negative feelings about student behavior at Highgate, and what you'll see is a shift that started last year at the same time as behavior referrals were going down. Way more people were saying it's getting better or staying the same than getting worse than it was the previous year, which is I think a victory, because kids are spending less time out of class, yet people think they're behaving better. So it's not like we're just saying, just deal with it. Take care of this and you're on your own. Because that would be the really nonsensical way to deal with kids leaving class too much, is just to say you can't kick them out of class. Maybe even more encouraging is the way that our teachers are thinking about student behavior. So when a kid misbehaves, this question asks, is it because of a lack of skills or a lack of will? A lack of skills is something that you as an adult have some control over. You can teach them some alternative strategies. If it's just a lack of will, you can, in your mind, just say, oh, that's the parent's responsibility, or that's because of something going on. I have no control over that. And it lends itself to a woe is me and I can't do anything about it mindset. In 2017, 2018, about 2 to 1 people were saying it's a willful thing. They don't lack the skills, they just don't want to behave. Not great. And then it kind of evened out last year, and then we've seen it come back the other way this year, where 18 out of 31 of our teachers said, actually, no, it's a lack of skill. We have some onus here. We have some, what's that word? Ability to make change. There's some word that's escaping. And then finally, the blue here is, the question was, what's the most important thing that we could do to improve student behavior? You remember what people's perceptions of student behavior were the first year? It's not surprising that almost 3/4 of people said consequences, more consequences. The blue is consequences. that percentage dipped to half last year, and it's down to about a quarter this year. At the same time, the green, this tiny sliver here, is better teaching and more teaching of behavioral strategies and skills. Almost non-existent, growing, now almost half as the main thing that we can do to improve student behavior. So it's really been a mindset shift alongside extremely positive results. So to answer Peter's question, okay, just because I went through a lot, I try to model good teaching, all that stuff summarized as succinctly as possible. We've seen a dramatic decrease in office discipline referrals, as well as a decrease in the share of our student body responsible for the bulk of those referrals. And at the same time, we've seen staff perceptions of student behavior shift in a positive direction generally, alongside a development of a much more progressive and restorative understanding of adults' ability to change student behavior. So that was the results. This is the how we got here. I'm mindful of everyone's time. I'm not gonna go through each slide. I think there's maybe more information, the more I think about it metacognitively right now than is useful for right here. But a summary is we've got really good staffing. We've dedicated a lot of our, and this goes back to when we were Highgate Board and Franklin Board and Swanton Board. The Highgate Board was extremely supportive of staffing. We have folks who are really dedicated specifically to our behavioral programs, PBIS, which I know is in Swanton, not in Franklin. And so PBIS and restorative practices are the two things, the two programs that we've integrated. And I'm not gonna try to explain what those are if you don't know, but suffice to say, they take a lot of effort to do well. You can do them in a really haphazard way pretty easily. If you wanna do them well, you need highly trained, highly competent people. We've got that staffing, and that's been supported by most of the Highgate School Board, because they were the ones who were passing the budgets that allowed all these people to come on board. So I'm very thankful to them for that. Our partnership with NCSS cannot be spoken for enough. They do a better job training folks to work in schools with students on behavior than anybody else does. We have lots of different kinds of support from NCSS. We have the one-on-one BIs for a handful. We have right now four of those highly trained BIs for kids who really struggle with behavior. We have a couple people who have a caseload of 10, and then we have some school-based clinicians who do a lot of our counseling work with our more more complex mental health cases. And finally, just a significant investment in training of staff. I'm gonna share this with Purette and she can attach it, so I'm not gonna go through it, but just an incredible amount of training that's not like the train you in August and then see you later till June, but rather lots of returning to the same ideas monthly, so people are getting lots of touches on the ball. And so the three sentence, oh, and finally, we developed a response to behavior policy that's just far more consistent across our school, so that'll be linked as well. I wanna try to summarize that stuff that I just rushed through, because I know your eyes are gonna glaze over if I go through every bullet, as succinctly as possible. So we committed to hiring staff to support an integration of PBIS and restorative practices together. We thought that both of them were incredibly important because they each have components that kids need in order to be successful at school. And we followed up with extensive training and coaching opportunities informed by those two frameworks for our entire staff, with a special focus on our new teachers who get none of this in their teacher prep programs. At the same time, we strengthened our partnership with NCSS, which has brought us highly trained behavior interventionists and consultants to help us develop programs for our tier two and tier three students who are driving a lot of that really hard behavior. for a long time. And then finally, we created a school-wide response to behavior policy that has a dual emphasis, first on dealing with minor behaviors in the classroom, and when that minor behavior becomes chronic, addressing it in a way that holds the integrity of the learning environment in especially high esteem, because we don't want behavior to get in the way of students learning. So I think it's felt really good here this year. I know that Chris Shepherd and Pat and I had a conversation a couple weeks ago about things are feeling really good, and I think a lot of the reason, and those of you who have been in schools know that behavior often drives climate, and part of the reason why I think it's feeling really good is because teachers are feeling really good about student behavior, at least relative to what it was. We have a long way to go, and there's a lot of work to be done, but the progress has also been incredibly hopeful. That's about that.
Good.
Any questions?
Good job.
Very good job.
Very good.
Yeah.
It really has been an amazing piece of work that you have spearheaded and really just been able to focus on, and it's just everything that is heard about climate and behavior in this building is very positive, and want to really make sure you're commended for that.
Appreciate it. Thank you for Jenna. Is it the agenda?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, and next up would be central office administration updates.
So I did pull together a newsletter for everybody. I didn't know you have in there a report from Robert about E911 compliance and the progress that's being made there. It's in process, and grant proposals are being put just even today. Wendy had a report. Tanya wasn't able to give me a report because I was telling people I may or may not need their information because it was a school vacation. So I didn't know if there was anything that either Wendy or Tanya wanted to share because they're here in terms of an update. I have an update on the coronavirus information that we get all the time, so I wanted to make sure I give you that information. You have only if you have something that you wanted to share.
It's all in the report.
Okay. So it's not linked here, but if you go into the site, I have linked a few updates. I gave you some updates as of last Friday from this Agency of Ed and the Vermont Department of Health around the recommendations for schools. And those are, I sent that letter out to all the community and staff around procedures and what the latest update is, and how if you have traveled to one of the countries, China, Iran, South Korea, or Italy, that you need to get in touch with the Vermont Department of Health, and the contact information is there. At this time, the Agency of Ed and the Vermont Department of Health are not making any recommendations about anyone outside of that. If children or families are sick in any way, if staff is sick in any way, as always, we want them to stay home. In particular, anyone who does not feel well, who's got any of the symptoms of a respiratory illness, should stay at home. The recommendations are still around hand washing, proper etiquette in terms of use of tissues and disposable of tissues. One of the most important things we can do as schools, which we do well, but our building and grounds directors have all been having conversations, and that's about how to continue to disinfect our schools and equipment at high levels. So all of that information has been pretty widespread throughout Vermont already, and we're making sure that that is available. What I have linked for you are two things, and I want to thank Tanya for giving me the link to Governor Scott's press conference with the Vermont Department of Health. They had epidemiology, they had emergency services, they had somebody else whose name isn't coming to me right at this moment. It's an hour-long press conference. Dan French was a part of it, so schools were spoken to specifically. They gave the latest information, the latest advice, so I've linked that in the agenda that is in your site, and if anybody has trouble getting that, I'll be happy to send it to you separately. And that's an hour long with questions and answers for everything. What I learned coming out of that is the Agency of Ed is working on two things. Today they went live with a web page that I also have linked for you all, where the Agency of Ed is having school specific place for any information and updates on COVID-19 and what schools should be doing. So that is in one place so that you can all look at that. And they are working on procedures should there ever be an instance in the future of having to close schools, what that would look like, how it would go about happening. And so they will send us those as soon as they have those put together. And there is going to be a webinar on Friday for superintendents on the latest information from the Agency of Ed around responding to the illness. At this time, we are all following the Vermont Department of Health's suggestions. So if things should progress, we will then, you know, take things one step at a time, whether it's restricting public events and so forth. And of course, we will keep you informed of everything along the way. So I wanted to make sure you knew the latest and had the way. And it's funny because just between Friday and Monday, I had to rewrite things between Monday and Thursday. So I just linked things because I thought it would be, things are evolving, so I wanted you to have the latest. And as of now, we still do not have a documented case in Vermont. We have someone currently being tested. There have been 7 people tested who were not found to have the virus. Another group of people are being tested, and that's, as of today, not known, the result.
Very good, thank you. Any questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to new business. And first one up on that is our annual motions that we do.
So I'm going to let Laura jump in. She gave you a piece of paper. We've already addressed the school designation, and we've addressed the board chair signing staff contracts and federal grants as needed. But we also...
Wasn't
federal grants? Okay.
No, we just did contracts.
All right, perfect. So the first one, Laura, why don't you go into that? It's something that we typically do.
Before we start, I'd like to make a comment that, and I already emailed Julie about annual motions because it didn't mean anything to me. So I have a real concern about, because it says new business, says action. Taking action on something that isn't warned. The public hasn't seen this. Annual motions doesn't tell me what we're going to be taking action on. So I have no problem going over it but I would propose that we don't take any action on these articles until our next meeting when it can be properly warned on the agenda.
The rest of the board agree with that?
What would the impacts of delaying this be?
There would be none in terms of
the really just
annual
the
grants.
That we have a new treasurer. These
These are very typical motions that every board does, a school board does at this time of year when they reorganize. So I apologize that it may be just be my familiarity with that that is causing that. As far as the grants, it can wait till the next meeting. That doesn't matter. The only one that would be a little bit of concern is the omnibus resolution, and that's just transferring your bank accounts, allowing us to still transact business into your new treasurer's name. Nothing else is changing. It's just transitioning to a treasurer. If we have to not sign anything until 17th.
So how about we do this as a compromise? We'll table the grants and all the grants, and we already did that one. So, and then still do the treasurer. Board okay with that, or?
Yeah.
We can do that, and I'm 99% confident that nothing will happen of it, but it does leave you open to someone could say that this wasn't warned, I didn't know about it, and it could null the decision. Like I said, I'm 99%. It's just, I think we should try to practice to make sure that we don't take action on things that the public has not been warned of.
Absolutely, we will make every effort to have those motions and needs for motions more explicit. We were making the list of those things that were required. As a new district, we did not always have, if you look at all the local districts, they didn't always make all the same kinds of motions to organize. And then in reviewing some other school districts as well as statutes, we were realizing, we need a formal motion on this one. So that's why they were added. But yes, I think that would be very helpful if we could get the motion for the authorizing the treasurer to, as there's been an election, making that change.
Okay, so at this point we're going to table most of this list except for number 4, which is a motion to accept the new People's United Bank.
Omnibus.
Okay. Omnibus resolution and signature cards for MVSD, which reflect the new treasurer, Georgette Roddy, authorized board chair to sign.
I'll move that.
Don was the first.
I'll second.
Steve was the second. Discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
I'll abstain.
Motion carries 601.
Just a little bit of clarification. Motion number 1 is very historic, and it's actually a requirement to apply for federal grants, any federal grants, and it has to include the language around IDFB specifically. So just in case someone inquires about that.
Is that the only one?
Yeah, the rest is, she's coming in tomorrow.
Okay. So next up is Highgate principal contract.
So obviously discussing a contract is something that's eligible for executive session. So if you want to discuss that in more detail about the contents of the contract, but the board did ask me to move forward with and negotiate with Yeshua Pastina for position of Highgate principal, and then the board would take action on that at this meeting. I did have that meeting with him, and he is very excited about coming here to Highgate and joining the leadership team. Very excited is probably an understatement. It was a very positive meeting.
So we will be voting on his contract next?
Nope, we'd be
after
voting
executive.
On it. Because obviously to discuss the details of an individual's contract is something that would be appropriate to find for executive session.
Okay. Next up is the MVSD student alcohol and drugs policy, possible adoption.
So you looked at it last time for a first reading. The only addition to your current adopted policy is the sentence that says, a student who represents a substance to be an illegal drug, regulated substance, or alcohol shall be found to be in violation of this policy.
So at this point, I'd entertain a motion to adopt that adjusted policy.
I'll make the motion.
I heard somebody, but Devin was the first. Second?
I'll second that.
Steve was the second. Any discussion?
I think that was a good additive.
Hearing no other discussion, all those in favor of adopting the policy as adjusted, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Okay, and then for our amended item, debriefing town meeting day.
Okay, since I suggested it, I'll start. I think I said earlier I'd like to have someone put it on the agenda for maybe next September, no later than October. And I don't know if Pierrette's a point person on this, or Julie, or Laura, but I think when we were in Franklin on Tuesday, there was a suggestion that maybe we devote, and I'm going to say a page, but I don't think that's what the wording was, but a written copy in our annual report reflecting the achievements, the accomplishments, the highlights of each school.
Mm-hmm.
So I would suggest that Franklin have a page, Highgate have a page, Swanton, the middle school have a separate page, and the high school. And it just be part of our annual report.
That's a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
As well as the principal's reports.
Oh yeah.
Yep.
We're not deleting anything.
Okay.
And if we can do color and photographs or whatever, but we can talk more about it, but I don't want to lose track of it. I think it's important. Another thing that I heard at a couple of meetings, and I'm sure all of you heard the same thing, and maybe you're going to bring it up, but you know me. I like to know that something's going to happen. I don't think we have to list all the teachers, but the question was about salary schedule.
Yes,
and
we hear
I think
that
that's
twice.
Appropriate
yep.
A salary schedule to go in. And if people want to do the detective work and figure it out, that's fine. But I'm not in favor of listing everybody's name with their salary, but I think a salary schedule would be good. And then if you come back to when we were at MVU, you know, people were asking, we got into a whole FTE number of people, but I do think there are little things that we can do to give people a better idea how stuff breaks down.
Mm-hmm.
So those were some of my takeaways from the meeting, and as I say, but I would just like to have Pierrette get those in the minutes so that when we go back, we can say, oh yeah, we were supposed to do that. And I think we will anyway.
Yeah, at the Highgate session, one of the discussions was the FTE. They'd really like to see, an FTE number assigned to, you know, each level, kind of like we did in the breakdown on the video that we put online.
Mm-hmm.
They'd like it in the end report.
Yeah.
Another suggestion that came up, I actually think Laura thought of it, but the the public we did have liked the idea. Is to maybe once we get a draft, have some people that don't look at this stuff every day look through our draft so that the information we put out is better read for somebody who doesn't look at this stuff every day, so we don't gloss things over that we think look fine but is unclear.
Bet you had a lot of volunteers too.
We actually had a couple.
Yeah, well, I'm being serious. I think that people would like have a committee just about something.
A little community input on that, I think, would be very helpful to see. Is this giving you as an average non-educator, business office person, the kind of information you're looking for? Because we do hear, you know, we hear people who want more information of one kind, and then we hear other people say the opposite. And I want more information about the schools, I just want those tax tables, or, you know, so I think it's a really good opportunity to
get some input from people and in a sort of formal way to help us develop the book, because it is an opportunity to communicate not just financial information, but a picture of our schools. And so we should use it as an opportunity.
One other idea that didn't come up at a meeting but came to me, and I think I talked to Laura a little bit about it, and I'll wait until we get our maintenance people here, but I think that the board has to have a discussion. You know, if maintenance people are buying wax and they're doing certain things, then we don't have to have a discussion about it. But I think it would be nice, particularly for new board members and maybe the public, if we sometimes discussed. I know in Swanton they try to take like so many rooms each year and replace the carpet, so that's usually in the budget. There are certain things that are, I'm sure every school does, with painting X number of rooms, you know, replacing furniture, so just so people get some comfort level of knowing where's that money going. And I know that the young man, is it John, who's the head man, maintenance man? In
Jason.
He did a very nice job with that when we did the tour. But I'm thinking, wouldn't that be nice to have in a report or somewhere for the public to know that we just don't wait 20 years and then paint the whole school. There is a plan.
We had that request from Ty as well to have a facility director's report specifically in the annual report, you know, maybe just a little kind of high level.
So I guess I'm on the same page as that. Mm-hmm. There'll be other things, but, you know, when the public makes a suggestion, I just want to make sure. You know, it doesn't mean we have to do it, but we do have to discuss it to determine if we're going to do it. Good. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Can I just add one thing that Ty, I think it was important. We had a lot of conversation around our processes and sort of like our organizational, central office and some of the supports to the schools. I think that's not a bad idea either. We had a lot of discussion around the fact that people don't necessarily understand how decisions are made and all the people that are involved or how often we're working one-on-one with the board. I'd like to work on that as well.
Yeah, almost like a virtual tour of how decisions and processes and procedures and policies are made. That it's not just at these public meetings now. There's also a lot of behind-the-scenes work that people don't get to see. Maybe we can find a way to highlight that in a couple meetings.
I'd just like to thank the board for being open to the idea and allowing us to have those meetings at the town meeting, the question and answer. It was very well received in Franklin. And I thank Julie and the administration and everybody for being there to answer questions. I had feedback afterwards because we have meetings there in Franklin. We have meetings here, but we don't always get the same, you know, you're more likely to get parents and that, which is great. Mm-hmm. But at town meeting, you get other people, and they were, you know, and I really thank Dawn for coming to Franklin, because, you know, it showed that we're more than just a Franklin board now, and he, you know, spoke very nicely, and it was really a good thing. So I really appreciate everybody's effort in making that happen and coming out. I don't know if this is the right time. I did get some feedback that I was asked a question that I couldn't answer, and I said I would bring it to the board. The question was about the bookmobile, the Franklin Grand Isle bookmobile. I was told that it used to be supported by the supervisory union. There was money in the budget for that, and it was taken out. And I'm not familiar with it, but they wanted to know, was it a select board decision to take that out of the budget, or what happened? So I'm not asking for an answer right now. I just wanted to throw that question out there.
I can follow up with Peter on that.
Okay.
Yep, absolutely.
Very good. So on to old business warrants.
That's you.
Okay, the warrants that I have here as of February 2020. Accounts payable $1,076,132.86. Payroll, which is checked, $65,085.56. Payroll, other disbursements, $1,484,186.01. Payroll deductions, $157,875.02. Bringing the overall total to $2,783,279.45 for the month of February 2020.
So I'd entertain a motion to accept warrants as read.
I'll make the motion.
Devin was the first. Second?
Second.
Jen was the second.
Oh, Jen did good.
Any discussion?
Just didn't see you.
Any discussion?
Laura, I know you had put a pause on spending for a little while. Is that period now over, or is everybody...
One more week. I think a lot of POs come in. The staff accommodated our request very well, so that was nice. Appreciate everybody's support in that.
Does that contribute to the February numbers being a little lower than what we've been seeing, or
what was it? I can't remember the 2.1 million.
Low twos.
2.7. They've been high twos to low threes every month.
Which is about right. Last month was a little higher because we had the NCSS bills hit the cycle, and it was 3.4 or something like that last month. Joanne, so just because you're new, we bring warrants after the fact for the month.
The previous month as a total, and there's some supporting documents there that, that show the payees and the dates and check numbers and that sort of thing, but all of those bills have been reviewed by the finance committee before they were paid. They always have requisitions and purchase orders attached to the backup, and that's what the finance committee goes through. This is sort of an after the fact of what we actually did to back and pay. Thank you.
You actually brought up a good point. I'm really bad at this too, so that's my fault, but we should introduce ourselves to you since you are a new board member. I mean, I know we have nice names,
yes,
like
that's what you tried to get out of.
And I apologize because of rushing in, and then there were students here, and if I had been thinking, I would have asked for us all to introduce you and welcome you as well. And we're very grateful to have you on board.
Yeah. So we'll start with you, and then we'll go around, and we'll introduce ourselves, and we'll...
Joanne Johnston, Franklin.
Negotiations committee member.
Lucky you.
Well, thank you for joining. I'm Chris Shepherd. I live here in Highgate. I've been on boards for 5 or 6 years now.
I'm Steve Scott. I've been on the board in previous years for 7 years in a row. Took about 15 years off. Got back on for another 2 and on for another 3 going forward. Thanks. It was a big fight.
I'm Jen Chibai, Highgate, and I haven't been on the board quite a year. I think it's June. June will be a year.
You know me. Laura McAllister, business manager.
I'm here at Bouchard School Board Secretary.
I'm Don Collins, Swanton, and I think this is my 15th, starting my 15th year. Some of it was elementary, Swanton, chaired that board, and then I went to MVU. I think I was there for 4 years. I lose track of it.
Peter Magnet from Franklin, and I got on the same time Jen did. I think we're 8 months now. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
Me too.
Jay Hartman, the high school principal at Missisquoi.
Devin Batchelder, also Franklin. It's my third year on boards.
I'm Jen Disorder. I'm the Director of Teaching and Learning at MVU.
I'm Tanya Hayes. I'm the Director of Student Support Services for the school district.
Wendy Cunningham, Director of Early Childhood Programs for the school district.
And this young man who was speaking earlier about behavior.
Hi. Chris Palmer, Assistant Principal at Highgate.
I'm Pat Harder, Principal at Highgate.
So, now that we
can
that.
I just say how happy I am as the business office to have Georgette Roddy as our new treasurer as well, and
yes.
Nola Gilbert supporting us as clerk. It's
mm-hmm.
wonderful to have great people.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm. Both are awesome to our district. Very dedicated people.
Yes.
Uh, Oh, yes. We never voted on, did we vote on awards?
We did
not. I didn't write it down if we did.
We did.
We didn't.
Final.
So now that we've really gone around the barn, how about we
had a long discussion.
Long discussion.
All because I explained the bill.
All those in favor of accepting check warrants as read, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries 7-0.
I'm glad you remembered.
Yeah.
That's why I write it down, because otherwise I get lost.
Checklist.
Pretty much. Other business, negotiations, updates.
So we've had further negotiations. Last night we had support staff negotiations. We have not had professional negotiations since that time. I think we have two more meetings scheduled. If we wanted any further updates to that, would need to be an executive session.
19th is the next one, right? The 19th?
The 19th.
For
professional. For professional, when we meet next, yes. And we do that, we'll likely meet an hour beforehand, and probably Don, you and I will meet beforehand.
Yeah, we'll try to meet beforehand.
Yeah.
And if when you and I decide we want to meet, if your schedule allows, you come to Julie's office, you just kind of do an overview, and then before that, we go to negotiations, or just be Chris and Eric would join us.
Okay.
There. But either way, if you feel, you know, like to become a little more familiar with it.
Sure.
And
time and date.
I announce all the meetings here coming up, so and I'll make sure to highlight that one for you. So next would be employee contract issue.
So I have two things that I want to talk to the board about in executive session, about contracts that need to come to your attention.
Above and beyond the Peggy principal. So we have
correct.
Three contracts to talk about in executive.
Yes.
Okay. And then we need to reschedule our April 21st meeting because that's right in the middle of vacation.
So we don't need to, but it was brought up before that the board may either want to reschedule because it does fall during a school vacation. I spoke with Joyce today. She wants the board to know that if you want to meet over school vacation in the library, she'll make it available. It's fine. She will have... she'll be there and do a regular principal update. If the board before, actually when we brought it up earlier in the year, we discussed whether we needed a board meeting, a second board meeting in April. So you can consider not having that, because if you make it the next week, then you would have two board meetings back to back. So we can keep it the same, we can reschedule it, or we cannot have the board meeting. So it's something that you wanted us to bring back to you as we got closer.
So what's the board's pleasure this time?
I must have missed something. So we're in Highgate this month. We were in Franklin last month. Is that because we lost a meeting somewhere along the way?
We're in Highgate because this is actually our MVU meeting.
Right.
But because of the way it all shook out, Highgate was short a meeting. So we gave one of the MVU meetings to Highgate. That's why we're here tonight. And then
we're in Swanton.
Swanton.
Where we'll do a tour of the Babcock
mm-hmm.
building
yep.
next meeting. And then we'll be at MVU on the 7th in April.
Okay.
And then it will be the 21st is what the current scheduled meeting would be, and that would be in Franklin.
Thank you.
So do we reschedule, cancel, or leave as is?
My main thought was families, some of you may not be around
right.
If you have plans for April vacation.
And then I was also thinking that's administration vacation too, so kind of unfair to have them come in on a vacation.
Well, I don't go anywhere, so. No.
I'm sorry.
Someday I will, I promise. But in terms, yes, I mean, that would certainly be a smaller meeting where we just do business and we don't really have any extras. Obviously, we wouldn't have families coming in. We wouldn't be
right.
doing that kind of a board meeting. I'm
going to be here.
If we move I would suggest we move it before the 21st rather than after the 21st. because I think what you're gonna find is when we start getting into May, a lot of parents, a lot of people have little league and have stuff going on.
Yeah,
after that
April
vacation.
I believe we have our negotiation meeting on the 14th, which would be the Tuesday before.
But the other thing is, as we get now the budget and hiring and things, it may be to Julie's advantage to be able to have us a little earlier rather than waiting to get into May, three meetings in May.
So with the 16th, that's the Thursday of the week prior. Sounds like Tuesday's already
talking about April.
Yep.
April
16th.
That's a possibility. And Joyce wanted me to let you know that she had not scheduled anything with anyone or done any advanced planning because she wanted to hear what the board wanted to do before doing that.
There's a meeting on the Tuesday before, correct? The 7th is our normal
Tuesday
meeting.
Before there's a meeting. I'm not aware at this time if there are any big events at MVU on the 16th.
Musicals.
The musical is that week?
The musicals on the
15, 16, and 17, I believe, however that falls. Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So you can
this
afford,
year, it's Chicago.
You can afford to miss one night, go to the other three shows.
Going to at least one.
So as of right now, I've heard the 16th. So I'm guessing at this point we want to reschedule. So if we're going to reschedule the 16th, does it work for everyone or no?
Can we make a musical that night?
And
do we
want to
do the night of the musical?
Well, we'll be in Franklin.
There's multiple nights of the musical, so that one doesn't bother me quite as much as something that's only scheduled one night. But
right, it's not like the middle school concert where you have three board members that are going to miss,
right.
You know, because of that.
It's not gonna be
I think that's probably better because you've got then a
who's
going to
be
week,
doing their taxes
a week and a couple of days between meetings, right? Rather than a Tuesday and a Tuesday.
Right.
And maybe it's a shorter meeting.
Yep. So is everybody on board with the 16th?
As far as I know.
At Franklin.
At Franklin at 6. It's right now at 6:30.
Yeah.
That's pending.
Right.
Okay, so
excellent, thank you.
Let's see, future agenda items. We still have policies we're working on and negotiations and administration contracts.
Yes, we have admin contracts that we want to bring to you next month. We at the next meeting, we discuss them. Teacher contracts are going to be coming up at potentially even the next board meeting. There were some other things I know. We want to talk about the stormwater project next steps as
next,
well.
Are you talking about the next meeting?
Yes.
I had thought it was earmarked for facilities.
Yes.
Primarily, okay.
Okay.
Laura, did you say that the maintenance people are going to come to the 17th?
Yes.
I don't know if it's one or all, by the way. Okay.
Okay. And future meeting dates. Our next meeting is March 17th at 6:30 in Swanton School Library. The next professional negotiations committee meeting with the association is March 19th at 6:30 at the MVU School Library, but the board meets in the MVU conference room at 6 prior to that. That would be our meeting with professional negotiations.
Did you want to make that 5:30 instead of 6 this time? I think you did that last time and it worked out pretty well to get the committee back on the same page.
It's been about 6 weeks since we met.
Right.
Sure.
So
we can amend
discuss
that
whether we need it to be 5:45 or.
Does that work for you?
It does.
Okay. So we'll change that to the board meets at 5:30 in the MVU conference room. I will do my best to be there.
Okay.
And then the next support support personnel negotiation committee with the association will be March 24th at 6:30 in the MVU school library, and they will meet prior in the MVU conference room at 6.
Well,
we're
going to
change that
too.
Yeah,
yeah,
we'll probably make that 5:30
too. Okay, so we're going to amend that to 5:30. Board will meet prior in the MVU conference room.
24th.
Unless there's anything else, we're ready for
a
motion.
Just for note, we do have another one on the 14th scheduled, correct, for April 14th.
We do?
We have another, unless you're just doing March.
Yeah, this is... the next meeting, it'll make that list.
Okay.
Yep. So, at this point, unless there's something else, we are ready for a motion to go into executive session.
I'll make a motion to go into executive session.
For contracts, three different contracts.
For three different contracts.
So, Jen was the first.
I'll second.
Steve was the second. Discussion. Who are we biting in?
We can invite Laura. If we're talking about money in the budget, possibly, if that question comes up.
Okay. So, inviting in Julie and Laura. All those in favor of going into executive session at 8:20, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
I should have said nay.
motion carries 7-0.
Richard used to do that.